Welcome to yet another exciting edition of The Checkpoint right here on Urban TV. My name is Nicholas Wasaja, and my guess is that it's a good evening for you out there. Today we are going to be discussing labor and the state of working conditions in Uganda. And this discussion is going to be centered around the effects of COVID-19 to laborers. To discuss this and more is Alex Asimwe, the Commissioner, Labor, Industrial Relations and Productivity in the Ministry of Gender, Labor and Social Development. Alex, welcome to the show.
Thank you. Good evening, Urban Television.
Now, many companies have resorted to downsizing as a measure of responding to the COVID-19 pandemic. And workers see this as a unilateral move that is unfair, especially considering that in some cases it does breach contractual obligations. As the ministry, what is your take on this?
Thank you. First of all, it is important to understand that the COVID-19 pandemic has affected both employees and employers in the equal measure. And this means that the effects of this pandemic are not only felt by employees, also employers are feeling these impacts. However, as government, you may recall, Ugandans, that the president guided on 1st May 2020 that employees should not be terminated. And why? His view and the government's view is that termination is expensive. Employers are encouraged to negotiate, to dialogue with workers. Because if you know that you are in the hotel sector and the hotel is not working, so why shouldn't you look at the best available methods of communication, of dialogue, of talking, of agreeing that the situation now is not okay, but it will resume because COVID this situation is not going to stay forever. It is going to change. And that's why for us in government, we are encouraging negotiation, we are encouraging dialogue, because the moment you terminate, what does it mean? That you have to adhere to the notice period or pay, that's money, redundancies, surveillance, the termination package. So if an employer opts for termination, it is very expensive at this particular time when actually we are feeling the heat of this pandemic. So that's the guidance. And the Ministry of Gender, Labor and Social Development, with over 159 labor officers across the country, are supposed to facilitate this dialogue.
But dialogue or negotiation to restructure payment and terms of contracts is the ideal. But in most cases, employers have gone ahead to arbitrarily terminate contracts without regard to the law. What's your take on this?
We have issued out national guidelines on the management of employment relations in regard to COVID-19 pandemic. And these guidelines are very clear. And also the law is very clear, because section 59, 1 and 4 requires that before you alter, before you change any terms and conditions in regard to salary, you must first seek consent or have an agreement with the worker. What does it mean? It means that if you contracted me, if my contract of service provides that I'm earning $1 million, and now you want me to earn 100,000, the law requires that before you issue out a written notice that I'm changing your contract of service from 1 million to 100,000, I need to first be involved in the discussions, agree, and then you proceed. And that's what the law provides. So all those workers where the salaries have arbitrarily been reduced and directed, the ministry, the government is coming in to help them. And this is also a call to employers that the law is very clear. You can sit with these workers, agree with them. In any case, the businesses that you know are being run, you know, in a human resource management professional caption, is that they are the workers are the owners of the business because they are the ones that facilitate the processes and the production. Number two, we have also seen a trend of what we call unpaid leave.
Yes, that's where I was coming. And it was introduced by the president saying that companies should consider unpaid leave. What does this term exactly mean? And is it supported by the law?
Now, the Section 23 is very clear of the Employment Act. It provides that a person can enter into a contract of service unless that contract fulfills the requirements of the Employment Act, meaning that you can't enter into a contract of service that contravenes the Employment Act. It therefore follows that a worker or an employer may agree with workers or a worker on terms and conditions of service that do not conflict with the Employment Act. Meaning that even that unpaid leave, because the president was very clear, is that it you must negotiate. It is not provided the law, but the law gives you a leeway for you to negotiate, to dialogue, and to ensure that the employer and the workers are all in agreement. I also need to say that this should not be master and servant in the traditional approach of employment relations. This is a kind of, it is a balanced situation. When you have a workplace, you have an organization, where employees or workers matter. Because without employees or workers, then it means that your business may not flow. So putting in place good human resource management principles of ensuring that workers participate in decision making of the company is good. And it is something that we encourage as government.
But does you talk of a master-servant relationship? Probably you should highlight whether this kind of relationship, if it is there in some cases, does support productivity in the labor market.
You see, productivity is influenced by many factors. Productivity is influenced by skill, by technology, by capital, by attitude and mindset, or what you'd call work culture and ethics. But the idea is that, and the law, even it is, you know, common law provides it, that the employer is at liberty to hire and fire. So, meaning that, but however, in undertaking that function of hiring and firing, consultation with workers is key. So, meaning that regardless of whatever happens at the workplace, the workers must be involved. Even if it is disciplinary, as you know, even if it is termination, Section 65 of the Employment Act requires that, you know, you have to inform. Even the notice period is there. So you have to be really give what we call good reasons for you to engage these workers if you want them to be out of contract of service. So they must follow the law, Employment Act, and other laws of Uganda. Number two, the contract of service. When you came to me looking for a job, I accepted and you signed a contract. And number three is a collective bargaining agreement that many of these workplaces have signed agreements with the labor unions. And these collective bargaining agreements contain certain provisions that are for, you know, beneficial to both employer and employees. So those are the three legal instruments that we encourage to follow, particularly if you want to enhance your productivity.
But you say employers are at liberty to hire and fire their workers, but if I hire and fire in any way that suits me as an employer, does that in any way have an effect on the remaining staff?
The idea is that an employer, if they are to hire and fire, first of all, if they are to terminate, the government of Uganda has laws that manage that function of termination. So, and the idea is that, for example, when you look at the law, section 31, it's very clear. Because if an employer cannot manage to pay wages, so the idea is that the contract of service has come to an end. And once it comes to an end, then there are processes that you must follow to end that contract. Section 58, the notice period, the section 65 of termination, you have to follow it up. Section 81 of collective termination, if you are terminating more than 10 people, then you have to notify the commissioner, you have to ensure you provide details of those who are affected, the names, you know, the salaries, and the terminal payment plan. Because many times you find employers terminating workers and they are not bothered in ensuring these workers access their terminal benefits.
Alex, you've been emphatic on renegotiation or negotiating the restructuring of contractual obligations. But there are scenarios during this COVID period where companies have, for instance, given notice that we intend to restructure contractual obligations. And these are the terms. But then you're simply handed a document and it's up to you to either sign and accept these terms or simply walk away. What does the law say in this kind of situation where the worker is between a hard rock and a hard place on making a decision, and do they have forums for redress?
Yes, absolutely. You know that government provided these guidelines and requested to all affected employees that in case your rights have been infringed, please reach to the nearest labor officer, register a complaint, because the law is very clear. That's the reason why the minister went to, you know, on national radios, national televisions, you know, trying to create awareness on the process of this employer-employee relations in regard to the COVID situation. So once, if an employer takes an arbitrary decision, then your duty is that report to the nearest labor officer. Now, the function of the labor officer is to facilitate dialogue. First of all, the labor office is a court of first instance. So because you know these labor complaints, and disputes, they are processed up to industrial court. Even some go up to the court of appeal. But they have to start with the labor office as a court of first instance.
But then, maybe for clarity, who is a labor officer? Because I mean, if I'm working in a manufacturing company that does weaves, I am probably a senior for graduate, I might not really understand who a labor officer is. And where do I find this labor officer that you're talking about?
So a labor officer is defined under the law as the commissioner for labor. And the law also further prescribes that the commissioner may delegate the function to the labor officer. So these labor officers are both at the Ministry of Gender, Labor and Social Development.
So you are a labor officer?
I am the labor officer. And you find other labor officers in the districts, or what you call the local governments. If you come to KCC here, you will find labor officers. If you go to Mukono, you will find a district, you know, a labor officer at the district. So these labor officers, their role is one, to facilitate social dialogue, to ensure that there is industrial harmony. Because one of their functions is to conciliate, mediate, and arbitrate. So the idea is that once conciliation has failed, then you can go to another level of mediation. And once mediation still has failed, then you go to another level of arbitration. And once arbitration, if a labor officer has failed even to, you know, to arbitrate, or one party is contesting, then they can go to the industrial court. And this industrial court is functional and it is in place. So if you are out there and you know you have been affected, please, we want to help you. Actually, you are better. The government is your best ally. So report, and then we will facilitate this social dialogue, we will mediate and even arbitrate. Assume that the mediation and conciliation has failed to work.
Probably this conversation is coming at the right time. Workers are accusing the Ministry of Gender, Labour and Social Development, trade unions, you, the labour officers at local government and all the other levels, of not coming to their rescue when employers are subjecting them to unfair, arbitrary contractual restructuring and layoffs and all those other effects that they have suffered during COVID.
No, actually, workers out there, I think they need to really appreciate that when you look at the steps that the government of Uganda has taken, for instance, to ensure that over 159 labor officers are functional. Because I remember, you know, 15 years ago, we had about 27 labor officers, but now, every district almost has a labor officer, fully functional and aware of what to do. Two is that we have provided information in newspapers, in radios, in television, and we have provided guidance. And our offices are open. We still request that if you are out there and you know you have your obligations, you know, or your rights are being infringed on, then please ensure that you reach the labor office. The government is your best ally. As you know, you are aware that on 22nd, during the national address, on update of COVID by HE, the president, he even directed that we should register all these workers that have been affected, and then design a response measure that can help them to sustain their incomes and remain in the labor market. So government, we are very, very committed in ensuring that the workforce is protected, but also in creating more opportunities for our people.
As we go for the break, are labor unions still relevant to workers in this country? Yes, government has done its part and has put labor offices all over the country, but are labor unions still relevant?
Yes, labor unions are still relevant and they are very critical. And in fact, these labor unions have even helped government, have helped us in solving some of the conflicts at the enterprise level. Because most of the enterprises subscribe to labor unions, and their workers also subscribe to labor unions. They have what we call collective bargaining agreements. And if they were not relevant, then we would not have collective bargaining agreements. So labor unions have helped. They are very, very critical. They are very, very important. They advance the protection of rights of workers, and that's why we have about 44 labor unions, because otherwise, if they were not relevant, we do not have that number.
But there is a feeling that government and employers are interested in weakened labor unions because sometimes they become political. You understand, for example, Uganda's political history is defined by strong labor unions. But I don't know, the feeling is probably right now they are so weakened they cannot raise their voices. And I'll give you an example or tell you why I'm saying this. During COVID-19, there are very many companies that have not remitted NSSF as provided, NSSF benefits as provided for in the law. So, but nobody is coming out to complain about this. Everyone is silent, and probably me, the worker, I would chicken out because when I weigh NSSF benefits vis-a-vis me retaining my job, I'd rather forfeit that right on NSSF.
First of all, that thinking that the government is not supporting labor unions is not correct. The correct point is that government wants labor unions to prosper, to flourish. And that's why the government of Uganda established the Labor Unions Act, put in place a Labor Unions Act that provides a framework for management of labor union matters in the country. And this law is there. Anyone can, you know, if you want to exercise your right of association, you can. These rights are under, even enshrined under our constitution. So that thinking, it is not correct because there are so many areas that the labor unions have raised and have come into policy.
Let's go for a break, Alex. You are still watching The Checkpoint with me, Nicholas Wasaja, and today we are talking about labor laws and the state of working conditions in Uganda with Alex Asimwe, the Commissioner, Labor, Industrial Relations and Productivity in the Ministry of Gender, Labor and Social Development. Alex, when we went for the break, we were still examining whether labor unions are still relevant in Uganda. Are you aware that there are companies that do not want their workers to join labor unions? Why is this so, and how can workers fight for this particular right if it is supported in the law?
First of all, the Labor Unions Act outlaws that situation you are talking about, where a worker is willing to join a labor union and an employer denies him or her that right, it's unlawful under the Labor Unions Act. And if you are out there and that is happening, number one, the labor union will launch a complaint to the registrar of labor unions. And the employer can be compelled to ensure that the workers are able to join the respective labor unions of their choice. Because this is a constitutional matter. You cannot deny a person from associating with a labor union of his or her choice. So the law is very clear. And if it is there, please use the available channels that are in the law to report this anomaly, and it will be dealt with henceforth.
Alex, what should workers do that have whose employers have not remitted NSSF?
Now, we need to understand that during this COVID, government negotiated with employers and employees, workers, organizations, that is not to cough to, Federation of Uganda Employers and even NSSF to pend the contribution for about, I think, 3 months. But then after, when the situation normalizes, they are supposed to do what? To ensure that those dues, their contributions come as definitely equity in some of the workplaces that have been affected increase. But if you know that your NSSF contribution has not been affected before, first of all, before COVID, the lockdown measures, please report, because it is also a matter that the labor officers handle. It falls under the Employment Act, under the section of statutory reductions on your salary. So if you know that you are there and your contribution, and we are, for example, we have received many workers, they come to us and said, I worked for 3 years, but when I went to NSSF, there is nothing. So we compare what I told you, the function of the labor office, we facilitated that social dialogue. So we reach the employer and bring this fact and the legal requirement to his table, and definitely he complies. So please report, report, report. But also from our side, we are increasing, we are going to, we have intensified labor inspections. So we'll be moving to schools, you know, all these private enterprises, even some public facilities, to ensure that the working conditions of workers are really good and sustainable to their livelihood and productive employment.
But Alex, you are aware that COVID-19 has virtually affected every other aspect of our lives, and it has redefined the way we do things. We are now talking of e-learning, we are talking of virtual tourism, we are now talking of scientific elections, and this by implication means that there is going to be job realignment. Do you, as a ministry or the Labour Office, do you have any policies in plan to ensure that we retool workers to realign them to the requisite work skills in the labor market?
Yes, the government of Uganda recently introduced what you call a Uganda National Apprenticeship Scheme. Now, this apprenticeship scheme, you know, it has not been in this country, but it is the only best way of learning that you acquire from the job. So for instance, if you've been in tourism and now the hotels are closed, you can go to construction. You start learning in the construction as a technician, but as you are working. Because an apprenticeship, a structured apprenticeship, is working, it is learning on the job. And you are being paid, and there is a structured social protection system. So we believe that this scheme, first of all, is going to help us to fight what we call skills mismatch. What is produced in school, sometimes it is not what is demanded in the labor market. Number two is that we have some Ugandans that have dropped out of school. And because you know, there is this what we call, there is this conceptual confusion in regard to what we call pedagogy, classroom teaching, is that a person can as well, after senior four, go to vocational, go to a garage, go to a construction site and learn, and is assessed and certified and accredited from there. So we expect the many young people to really go into this apprenticeship scheme, and it will also help us, you know, in terms of skills, skills improvement. So that's number one. Number two is that you already know that the government of Uganda has made it serious line of support to Uganda Development Bank. So the money is there, because in case you want to learn, in case you are under a company and the company wants skills upgrade for the workers, the company can access low credit. There is also what we have done as government in terms of you know, tax measures. all those are intended that, you know, enterprises are able to flourish. They are able to retain equity, because once enterprises are able to, you know, have equity, it means that they will have resources even to, you know, build their workforce to the target that they want. So those different measures, we hope that are able to help us, you know, go through this situation that is somehow now becoming.
But Alex, these companies that you're talking about, for example, are using COVID-19 as an excuse. They are not really battered, but they are simply using it as an excuse to save more money and really push their workers against the wall. So in your heart of hearts, do you think a company that is simply using COVID-19 as an excuse is the same company that is going to go and seek cheap credit so that they can retool their workers will be in position to do this?
Yes. I can tell you, look at the example of Java's. Before COVID, they never had this distribution.
But Java's could be a drop in the ocean.
No, I'm just giving you an example that we have seen many companies that have gone into e-marketing. So how do you go into e-marketing when you have not trained your staff? An employer may, directors may be two in a company, may be three, but they have workers, and workers must work and ensure that the company gets, you know, an income. But they have been involved in the e-marketing. So meaning that some companies have taken a deliberate effort to ensure that they upskill their workers. So, and that's also one of the requirements in our labor standards, that you should continuously improve your workers such that they are better, such that they are relevant to the technology, to the labor market, you know, to the global needs. The global needs of the market.
According to the International Labour Organization, out of every six young people that are in the workforce, two have been forced out because of the COVID-19 pandemic. Now, these are the majority. With the country has been decrying unemployment. So that means this is going to even sink lower. The magnitude is going to grow larger. Do you have a strategy in place to ensure that you cushion the economy against these effects?
Yes, one is that you recall in the State of National Address, the President earmarked several measures for, you know, cushioning our, you know, our economy. And some, those stimulus packages are to do with low credit, tax measures, to the extent that even we have introduced what we call cash for work program, meaning that you have young people out there, well-boarded, and they have no jobs. So what government is saying is that we are going to put money in the public intensive works program, such that some of these public work systems, like feeder roads, small feeder roads, waste management, you know, drainage, you know, all that, can be done by a group of young women and youth, and then the money will be there. So, but other than that, is that you will see that the intervention for the government of Uganda are very robust in two ways. Number one is that, first of all, we have serious interventions in capital accumulation. We have put money in UDB. We have advised the banks to restructure their loans. That one has been done. We have put money in Uganda Development Corporation. We have even put more money in Uganda Microfinance. Now, in terms of skills, we are coming up with apprenticeship skills scheme to ensure that, you know, we are able now to really come up with the skills that are required by the job market. Because through apprenticeship, that's why when you take your car to a young man in a Wandegeya market, the young man who never studied engineering is able to really dismantle your engine, put it back. So that young man, we now saying now, want to, first of all, examine you, certify you. Then you will have a certificate as a technician in engine maintenance. And that means that young man can go anywhere, can access Toyota, can access Nissan, can access BMW, can access, you know, because he's going to be internationally accredited and certified. So the skills development, and as you know, we have also put enough money in Bitvet, and we are encouraging, you know, Bitvet. Now, that's notwithstanding with the enrollments that we have achieved, 8 million, you know, in the lower primary. That's huge. Now, from there, technology. Because apart from the fundamentals of the economy, which is power, which we have done well, we have a surplus, roads, we are now working on standard gauge railway. Now, another important aspect, security. Because once you have those fundamentals clear,
that's all hardware. Uh-huh. Where is the software?
Now, because the software is the one I've told you, that you have technology, ICT. We have put more money in ICT. And that's why you see the plan of government is to ensure that the entire country in the next, you know, 1 year is connected to the broadband. You can access internet wherever you are. Whether you are in Kasese, you are in Adjuman, you are in Busia, you should be able to do what? So, in terms of robust intervention that the government of Uganda has put in place, I would like to appeal to the young people that, yes, look at these opportunities that the government of Uganda has provided. And please access them. The youth fund, the MIOGA, the women fund, the money in microfinance, please access them. Because it is the only way that you will get out of what? Out of poverty. And government continues to sustain and improve those fundamentals. Because don't take those fundamentals for granted. If you want, you can go to Somalia and talk about skills. You will not even talk about skills. Because security, these enablers of doing business are very, very critical. So I appeal to the young people that let's take advantage of these programs.
But Alex, you might buy the mambas, you will construct the roads, and you will do all that. But if, for example, the young people do not have social security nets, and then there isn't robust social protection measures, then that is also a ticking time bomb.
Because you see, I don't know what kind of a country that has put in place youth funds, women funds, cash for work, has money for skills, has put money in financial institutions, in circles, and continues to improve on the infrastructure, on water, on electricity, on roads, on ensuring that, you know, health care. Because, let me tell you, can you imagine that Uganda, the Uganda you know, we have managed to contain this pandemic better than many, many countries that are, you know, where their GDP is even higher. And remember, we had issues of floods, we had issues of the locusts, and now COVID came in. But, you know, the economy, the workforce, the people are able to work and sustain, even up to now. That's why you see our cases are not skyrocketing. They are not skyrocketing because it means that the government has very good, robust systems.
Don't you think it's too early to celebrate?
No. There is no need of saying that it is too early to do what? To celebrate. Because the number one is that the essentials are there. The willingness of government to respond is there. And we have done that.
One of the challenges that has come to the fore during this pandemic has been occupational safety and health, especially for casual laborers. But even before this, before COVID-19, you are aware that people, especially in the casual labor, have been subjected, have been exposed to injuries and diseases like COVID-19. They do not have protective gear. What are you doing as labor officers to ensure that employers adhere to occupational safety and health?
Yes. First of all, we have a law in place, the Occupational Safety and Health Act 2006. And it is very clear. It provides for an employer to put in place safety and health measures for the protection of his or her workers. And our labor inspections have been targeting those workplaces that do not put in place what we call adequate safety and health measures. Now, once we find out that your workplace is not complying to the law, number one is that we first sensitize, and that's what we've been doing. We sensitize, we do what we call enterprise-based sensitization and inspection.
So who do you sensitize, the employers or the employees?
Both. Because when you go to a workplace X, you will find there the employer, you will find their employees. So as you do the inspection of the entire facility, because the non-compliances, most of them are from inadequate awareness. So we ensure that these employers are aware of the legal requirement. Then number two is that we go ahead, you know, to provide standards, materials to them that if, for example, your employers are working in a noise environment, number one is that you must first measure the decibels. Are they below 80? And if they are above 80, then it means you need to protect the workers. Now, what type of personal protective equipment? So all those details, we give these employers standards and workers, including workers standards. And then when they fail, that's when we do enforce. You know, we take you to industrial court. Now, the issue of casualization, I need to clarify that all workers deserve protection. Not only, we should not think that only casual laborers, no. All workers, permanent.
You see, what I was saying that is that probably my producer might know an address where they can channel their challenges for redress, but someone who is probably simply packing cosmetics might not know where to channel their challenges.
So, first of all, the law provides that casual laborers can only be employed for 4 months. So, meaning that I don't expect to see employers employing casual laborers 10 months, 2 years, no. The law outlaws that kind of an arrangement.
Why?
Because we need workers, we need people to be in formal employment. Casualization of labor has limited social protection coverage. And therefore, we appeal to the employers to ensure that there is a progressive improvement in the workforce standards in different enterprises to ensure that if somebody entered as a casual but has been groomed, then this person can now go into formal, gets a contract, and even goes into permanent. So that's the rationale behind. But also we know that a person who remains in casual for a long time, then the disadvantages are more than advantages.
But you are aware that there were people that did not have contracts, especially going to the category of casual laborers, that did not have contracts. And in the process, when we were hit by the pandemic, their stay at work was terminated without being paid. How can your office be of help to these people? I was hired for 4 months. I worked for 3 months as a casual laborer. COVID hit, as forced out. I wasn't paid. where do I go?
Please, if you are there and you know that your rights have been infringed, please try as much as possible to reach the labor office that is either in the district, in the Kampala Capital City Authority, or at the Ministry of Gender, Labor and Social Development. We will facilitate social dialogue, we will do mediate, and even we will arbitrate in case mediation fails. And I would also like to clarify that you will call around April. We issued out a notice, a special announcement to all employers and workers, those who have been affected by COVID, to ensure that they comply with labor returns and statistics requirement. Because we want to get data on those who have been affected so that it can help us to facilitate good decision making, but also programming on the response interventions. So the labor office is the answer where you can go and get the support.
In the trade unions you regulate, one of those that are most vocal are in the education sector. But there is a challenge that has been rampant, especially in the private players in education. Teachers and other staff members, when the terms close, they are never paid because the students are not there. Yet when I take leave as a journalist, it's paid leave, you get it. And the feeling is that when people go on holiday, this should be categorized as paid leave, you get it. This has been excavated by COVID-19. How can teachers and staff in the education sector out there be helped?
Now, you know that the president has already directed on this issue. We are going to register all the workers who have been affected in education institutions, and we are going to design a response. However, our design for the response intervention for being out of work because of the lockdown measures, because remember all the schools have been closed. So we'll come up with the response measures in line with the HE, the president's directive in that line. However, what you have talked about, the situation where a teacher, when they go into holidays, they are not paid. When they go into leave, they are not paid. That comes to the compliance to the labor standards, to our labor law, because the law is very clear. But also, we also need to look at what we call contract of what? The contract of service. Now, the teachers, when they are signing the contracts of service, that's what we need to investigate, interrogate. What is their contract of service? What does it say? Because if you sign the contract of service saying that you will only be paid when you are at the school, then the employer will be protected.
How many people in this country do sign contracts of service?
Now, the idea is that I also wanted to clarify that even if you have not signed a contract, you can still get remedy through the labor office once you report. So we look at the what we call the facts and the issues. First of all, the circumstances under which you are employed. We look at the law. If there is a contract, we look at it. If it is not there, you know, we look at the guidelines, what they provide. If they are not there, maybe you find that, like UNATU has the collective bargaining agreements, we look at those, what they provide. But the idea is that the management of employment relations must be looked at under the three broad areas. The law, what does the law say? And I needed to say that much as you don't have a contract, the law implies that as long as you are working, if, for example, you come to me and you start working as a technician and have not given you a contract, if you go to a labor office, it doesn't matter. The contract is implied. The fact that there was that willingness and executed, and there is evidence to that, the contract doesn't.
The law seems tilted in favor of laborers and workers.
Yes, the law is definitely, because we know that the workers are the, you know, more vulnerable, so they need protection. So the contract is good, you must. By the way, even when you don't give contracts, it is an offense under the Employment Act, because Section 59 is very clear. It provides that once you give a person a job, you must give what we call written particulars. Written. The place of work, the salary, the leave, the statutory deductions, you know, all those. So meaning that there are two things. The law is clear in such a way that the framers looked at the possibility that there are some workers who may be denied what? A contract, but provide work.
But don't you think the time has come for you to start thinking of civic awareness in terms of bringing down the labor laws so that everyone is abreast with them? Because these are good laws that protect workers, but there seems to be ignorance out there.
Yes, we have planned to, first of all, come up with a popular version of these laws, simplify them. We are going to simplify them. We are going to put them on digital platforms, you know, major silent issues, the Employment Act, workers' compensation, all this. And also we are going to ensure that they are in different languages, maybe major, not all, but, you know, at least major languages in this country, such that, you know, workers and employers can be aware of our national standards requirements when it comes to workforce management in a workplace.
Parliament approved the minimum wage bill, but government seems to be moving around in circles. What is the problem?
No. I think you see two things. This minimum wage, yes, it is good, but I want you to look at the broader. Okay, the fact is that government is, we are working to ensure that we finalize the report and go back to cabinet. So we presented to cabinet a report, minimum wage advisory, you know. But then cabinet asked for more information. So we are getting, as a technical wing, we are getting more information to back up or brief or strengthen the report and then go back to cabinet. And thereafter, cabinet will pronounce on the minimum wage. But let me say something. Ugandans, you see, it is these interventions that the government of Uganda is putting in place that will make you competitive and productive.
What do you mean there?
I mean that there are so many interventions that the government of Uganda has put in place that comes to skilling, comes to capital, comes to the neighboring environment that Ugandans should take advantage of. Because let me tell you, even if your minimum wage is 10,000, but I tell you, if you are good, you will tell your employer that I can only be hired 50,000.
Alex, we cannot continue this conversation. We just thank you for making time to the checkpoint. We've been talking to Alex Asimwe, the Commissioner Labor, Industrial Relations and Productivity in the Ministry of Gender, Labour and Social Development. Be sure to catch the checkpoint tomorrow, same time. Good night.